welcome to Talks at GS. I'm Jake Seward, Global Head of Corporate Communications here at the firm. And I'm delighted today to be joined by John Dickerson. John, as you probably know, is a correspondent for 60 Minutes. And if that's not enough, he's also a contributing writer to The Atlantic and a co-host of Slate's Political Gabfest podcast, which I can't recommend highly enough. John's covered politics and the presidency for decades, probably since he was a teenager, and is out with a new book called The Hardest Job in the World, The American Presidency. John, congratulations on the book. It's nice to see you, and thanks for being here.
Good to be with you. I started this journey in covering presidencies with you many, many, many years ago.
Many, many years ago, yeah. It seems like just yesterday sometimes, and it seems like decades others. Okay, so, John, let's get straight to it. You make clear in the book that this is not about a particular president, the current president or others. It's about the job itself, and it's an indictment of the job. You say Donald Trump's tenure has offered a chance to take a sweeping look at the office. You've been writing this book for a decade. So talk a little bit about how you came to the idea of the book and what is it that's concerned you about the office or the job of presidency?
Well, I guess, as I've been thinking about what was the starting event for this book, it was in George W. Bush's driveway in Crawford, Texas in 2004. I'd gone there to interview him for Time magazine, and we were standing in the driveway at the end of the interview, and he said, you know, if you want to know about a person and whether they can handle the job of the presidency, ask them how they make decisions. What's their process? What kind of people do they like to have around them? And then how do they make the final call? And what struck me in that moment was, after covering so many campaigns at that point, I recognized a distance between what we talk about in campaigns, which is often whatever shiny thing happens to be happening at the moment or whatever controversy there is or conflict. And it's separate and apart from what the job actually is, which is making a series of decisions, many of which are never good. You know, it's basically a choice between something that's bad and something that's maybe awful. And you have to figure out which is which. So it started me on a path of looking at what the job actually entails and then comparing that against the way we talk about the job. And so for the book, which I started several years ago in a series of articles I wrote for Slate, and then I wrote a cover story for The Atlantic on similar themes, it basically was an idea of look at the basic formation of the office, why it's gotten bigger, and whether the disconnect can be repaired between the initial founder's conception of the job, the way we conceive of it now, and the way it actually is now. And so as I go through that journey in the book, I hope people kind of will come along with me and draw their own conclusions.
Let's go back a little bit as you do in the book. Obviously the founders had concerns about the office of the presidency and it becoming too powerful. How has the modern presidency differed from what the founders had in mind when they created the job in the first place?
Well, when they created the job, they wanted it to be, and this is one of the things in going back and looking at the summer in 1787, those 4 months, these men sweated it out in a room where they nailed the windows shut because they were trying to be so secretive, they didn't want anybody eavesdropping at the windows. So you can imagine, dressed in the way they were back then in a hot summer with the windows shut, it probably got a little ripe in there. And they were essentially redrawing the country's founding document 10 years after they had their first crack at it with the Articles of Confederation. And what I learned going through all of this is just the sense of risk. I mean, they were basically redrawing things and doing a do-over 10 years after they'd started, which had implicit in needing to do that do-over the fact that they had failed in running this new country, which was always the worry, which is that they'd be good revolutionaries and terrible at governing. And so with the stakes that high, they decided to do something that was itself incredibly risky, which was to add more power to a centralized office, the presidency. 10 years ago, they'd just gotten rid of a monarchy because of all of the things they were now consciously adding back to their government. Centralized power in one person, a person who could act in secret without letting everyone know, a person who in some instances would have more power and would have veto power over the representatives of the whole country, all of which was very radical. So, but it was very, very limited. And the president was to act with dispatch and energy in the times and moments that it was required to execute the laws that Congress passed, but was a really a secondary office to Congress. And we've obviously switched that. And where that has flipped, basically, it starts with FDR in the response to the Great Depression. When FDR came into office, there were editorials from people like Walter Lippmann saying, you know, he should be given dictatorial powers. Just give him all the power and let him fix this Great Depression. People were willing to give the president powers to fix things, but then the idea was they would kind of shrink back and the presidency would go back to its kind of steady state, which was not an office with such power. But then you had the Second World War, then you had the Cold War, then the War on Terror. So it increased all of these instances in which you basically had to have a permanent war state in the executive office because you needed to act with energy. And then I won't go on too much more about all the other things that have piled on, but you know, when you look at the response to the 2007-2009 Great Recession, the speed with which the Bush administration had to respond was so much faster even than the Mexican peso crisis that you would have been involved with during the Clinton administration. And what Robert Rubin writes about in the Mexican peso crisis is that sovereign debt used to be move at a much slower pace, but what they found was that it was moving now at the speed of fiber optics, which meant you needed that same kind of emergency presidential response on economic matters that you didn't used to require in a presidency. Now everything's even faster. And if you look at the relationship between the President Bush and Congress during the 2007 period, they had to move very, very quickly. And it required a whole set of behaviors in an administration that really hadn't been there before, but that are now, as we've seen with the response to COVID-19, basically a central part of the job, all of which is, again, not in its original blueprint.
Leon Panetta, who's my old boss, you quote him saying, the modern presidency has gotten out of control. And that's classic Leon. He's always very candid. What do you attribute the out of control nature of the presidency to? Is it the changing expectations around the job or the fact that presidents have accreted all this power? Why is it out of control today?
I think it's out of control today for both of those reasons, which is the to-do list has gotten longer. There are more things the president has to do. We haven't talked about the presidential response after disasters, but you know, presidents have at big moments had to respond all throughout the presidency. But now it's a kind of constant requirement that presidents show up, be briefed before natural disasters, show up after natural disasters, always play a kind of pastoral role for the country. That was not in the original conception of the job, and nor was it a part of the job really up until Johnson. The to-do list has gotten a lot longer. It has also gotten more complicated. The Cold War, the stakes were very high, obviously. The stakes are maybe a little bit lower now, but they are so much more complicated. Jim Jones, the National Security Advisor to President Obama, said that before going in to meet President Obama, he was his first National Security Advisor, he would draw up a list of the real challenges they faced on any given day, and he could number it from 1 to 10. He said if he made that list now for the president, it would be 1 to 25 in terms of the complexity of terrorism, cyber terrorism, nuclear war, conventional warfare. The Russians are messing around all kinds of different places. Climate change has changed in the national security picture. We now obviously have a pandemic. So on the national security front, it's just become more complicated. We talked a little bit about on the financial front, both areas, the emergency firefighter role of a president and an administration, but then there's the stewardship role of putting your country and your fiscal house in sufficient order that it can withstand the shocks that are inevitable and are coming. One of the things that's crucial to understand about the presidency and the way we talk about it in campaigns, which is another thing that has made the job harder, which is that in the campaigns, we talk about it like an office in which we're electing a superhero who can swoop in and take care of all of these very complicated problems relatively quickly or with the force of their will. That the only thing keeping us from addressing these problems is just we don't have a sufficiently dynamic leader in the post. Surely a dynamic leader is an important and necessary condition to solve those things, but lots of other things are important too. Nevertheless, in campaigns, we treat it as if presidents have all of this power, and those expectations that have been raised so high make the job harder because we're more brittle on when a president doesn't come in and perform at that level. Then finally, Congress has abdicated or shrunk from a lot of its duties and roles, which means the president no longer has a governing partner. And it means that their Congress isn't doing a lot of the work it could be doing to take things off of the presidential plate. Part of that is because Congress has just handed a lot of its power to the White House. Part of it's also because partisanship has made it impossible to work on bipartisan deals of the kind that even existed during the Clinton administration.
So as one of my bosses likes to say, you've done a great job outlining the problem. What are you going to do about it? Right. You fit in a little bit to the hiring process. Like, you talk about how the hiring process for the job of presidency is broken, and we take hiring a CEO more seriously sometimes than we do hiring the president of the United States. Do you think that'll ever change? And what is it liable to change for the better as we think about the future?
Yeah, your boss has it exactly right. And it's why when I was done writing the book, I mean, although through the book, I identify some areas I think we should pay some attention to, but it's why the final chapter goes on at some length trying to figure out where to put our finger down on trying to fix some of these problems. I think one place we can do it is in campaigns. We can lower our expectations for the job in the sense that we should understand, not lower them, that's not right, because high expectations that can't be met are kind of a crucial and important and useful part of the job, which is, if you lower the expectations too much, then mediocrity seems to be okay. Keeping the expectations high, we recognize no one will ever meet them, but the striving and the norms that presidents try to maintain have pulled presidents to greatness. Lyndon Johnson certainly would be one of them. But what can we do? Well, we can change the way we think about the office so we understand the component parts that are required in a president. If we think of it as a job ad interview, what are the attributes that we need for a president to do the job as it actually exists, not to do the kind of West Wing version of the job, West Wing, the television show version of the job? And if we focus on those attributes, one of them, for example, is team building and management. When I went around and did interviews with people who'd served in White Houses, former White presidents, CEOs, heads of philanthropic organizations, I would start every interview by saying, if you were treating the presidency or presidential campaign as a job interview, what's the first question you would ask the, you know, smiling applicant across the table from you? And they, almost all of them said, they would ask how they put together teams, how they hired people, what they were looking for, and what their relationship was with their teams. Well, that already challenges one of our notions of the presidential campaign, which is, we always talk about the president, but a presidency is an organization. It's not just the head of the organization, but we never really talk about that in campaigns. If we did, we might see, A, if they had this skill, which is the skill for building teams and then operating as a unit. We certainly see, there's a great quote from a disaster expert in the New York Times, one of the stories looking at the slow and inadequate response of the Trump administration to the COVID-19 challenge. And the disaster expert says, it's the wrong time to hand out business cards when the disaster has hit. And the point, of course, is you need to have your team in place, have built an operating tempo, and understood how you work with each other long before the challenge comes. And the challenge comes to every presidency. And it's just one thing we should recognize. And so if we think more about team building and whether the president has any skill, or if they don't have the skill, because not every president can have every skill required for the job, do they understand that? And what's their theory about how they're going to fix that? And then we can go on and on. But also another key. So I guess my first answer to your question is just recognizing the skills that are required for the job and then testing during campaigns whether the candidates have them, which will both A, help us determine whether they have them, but B, change the nature of our conversations a little bit so that we think more about the job the way it is. And then, of course, in the final chapter, I have lots of other ideas about how to make Congress less partisan, how to maybe on, you know, I'm rather critical of the job I've done and we've done in the press in covering presidencies. There are some ways in which we can cover it a little bit more intelligently that inform people, that don't just hover around conflict, but help people see through and get through conflict, or at least feel some sense of control during these moments of conflict and disorder. I'll stop talking because I could go on till dinner.
Well, I was going to ask you about that next, because I've worked on a number of presidential campaigns. You've covered them. Substance isn't typically at the heart of campaign coverage by the media. They're much more interest in the polls and the process and the theater and who's up and who's down. And, you know, and I read that stuff too. So I can't be a critic, and long, pieces, thoughtful pieces about policy tend to get very few readers. So how do we change that dynamic? I mean, we all see it, but is there any hope that campaign coverage will do a better job of sorting out, is this person the right person for the job?
Yeah, exactly. Like a huge plate full of spinach is not going to solve our problem here. And you know, and I got into the business because of the drama, and I mean, that wasn't the only reason, but the sweeping narrative and drama of a presidential campaign is absolutely it's so alluring and so fantastic. And I wrote, my last book was all about presidential campaigns of the past, because they're wonderful and amazing dramas. I think that, you know, we used to have campaigns. I mean, there are a couple of things. One, campaigns used to be more substantive, even though, as you quite rightly point out, substance wasn't always at the heart of them. But candidates used to have to make arguments. And in the arguments, they used to have to build a case. And the case was at least loosely associated with the facts. And I remember my first real I covered the 92 campaign, but my first real one was 1996. And I remember event after event with policy experts who would come to the rally and try and explain the policy to the, you know, to those of us just being introduced to it for the first time as reporters, both in the Dole campaign and the Clinton campaign. So policy's kind of fallen out, even though it was never at the center. I think policy is one part and then attributes are the other. And this is one area where I do think people do have an appetite for discussions about leadership and what makes great leaders and what makes, I mean, when I was doing the work on the book, I spent a fair amount of time reading through and talking to people who are leadership experts. And the number of books on leadership and hiring successfully as the corporate world has had to change from a model where you hired from within to one where you're constantly building and managing talent. If you see how obsessed people in the working world are with managing and keeping and honing good talent, I wonder if talking about that in the presidential context will introduce people to a conversation that they're more naturally interested in, instead of, you know, having a long discussion about change CPI, which is not something that everybody's going to get very excited about. I think it's the job of the press to spend more of its time focusing on attributes. Even the way we cover policies is kind of silly, because we say, well, candidate A wants this and candidate B wants that. And then that's all we say. We never say, well, is there any chance on God's green earth that any of this is going to happen? And when the person is in the position of trying to make these things happen, what are the trade-offs that are going to result from doing that? I mean, so for example, when President Trump went right after the Affordable Care Act in his first act almost in office, it not only was a challenge to the existing healthcare scheme, but it was also sending a signal for the way that relations were going to exist between the president and the Democrats in Congress, which would then spoil all kinds of other things they might do, because he was going after something that was quite important to Democrats. So if we think more about the actual reality of trying to pass some of these policies, that might put us a little bit closer again to what the job actually is in our conversations in the press and in the public than in this job where we're so where it's just kind of a bit of a fantasy in which we can just basically be theater critics and not have to wrestle with what the job actually entails, whether it's policy or presidential attributes that are required.
One of the things that you talk about is repairing the job of the presidency, not just the way we hire it. And you clearly think there's too much on the president's plate, and that's a problem. If you think if you can somehow clean up the job, would you get more? Would you attract different kinds of candidates if the job was a little more focused, more of a manager job? And we have this perennial interest, Bob Iger and others, Howard Schultz, in considering running for president. Why is it that most business people aren't, at the end of the day, walk away from trying to get the job?
Well, and this is not it feels like a modern phenomenon, but it's actually not. Basically, running for the job requires a whole different set of skills than being successful in the job. And the problem is with people who have run large organizations and who have shown an aptitude and have the scars to prove it, and have accumulated the wisdom that is required to run within a big, large structure. Those people operate in a certain set of ways that make it very difficult for them to campaign. Campaigning is a very weird and brutal thing, which we've come to see as a prerequisite for doing well in office. And while there are parts of campaigning that are absolutely crucial to understanding the job, it's not the same thing as the whole job. And we've come to the position where we basically think if you can do it in the campaign, you can do it in the presidency. And that's just not true. Again, there are important skills which are required in the presidency that you also use in the campaign. But a lot of the businessman's skills, or I've thought of it more in terms of running large organizations, large diverse organizations that require risk-taking, creativity, adaptation, delegation, priority setting, focus, hard-won optimism, not just happy talk. All that stuff is would be really useful in the presidency, but nobody who has all those skills has also been a lot of them haven't tried, but those skills aren't the ones that a campaign selects for. Even at the turn of the century, one of the great jokes about the presidency was that no man who was worthy of the job could actually get elected to it.
You're going to embark on your 7th or 8th presidential campaign, depending where you start right now. Do you have any hope, given all that we've talked about, that it will be different this time? It's certainly different because of the pandemic and the way the campaigns are being run. But is there any sense, given the press's sort of second guessing of their own coverage of the last election, that the coverage might have a slightly different tone to it, a more constructive tone, maybe?
Well, you can hope. One of the things that sometimes happens in campaigns is, the line everybody says, this is the most important campaign of our lifetime. And so that's been true of every single campaign because it feels that way, or it's required that everybody has to say that because it's in everybody's interest to keep the stakes high, right? The candidates want the stakes to be high so that everybody pays attention to what they're saying. The press wants everybody to keep the stakes high because they want everybody buying their newspapers or watching their television shows. Turns out stakes are quite high right now, both with the response to COVID, but also obviously the economic devastation that has resulted. And then we are in the middle of a racial, people have called it a reckoning. It is certainly a reckoning, but it's more than that. There is a continual problem with racial inequality in America that needs an answer. These are three great challenges. They are challenges to be met in their own right. They are also challenges that have exposed existing inequities in the American system that require considered wise thought and perhaps some solutions. And then finally, they are all a symbol of what the presidency is, which you know, which is that it is a job of big, high-stakes surprises that come out of nowhere. Some of these things are not a surprise. The idea that a pandemic would hit America is not a surprise. We know that it's not a surprise because presidencies have been training for it since the Bush administration. We know it's not a surprise because there's a guidebook on how you're supposed to respond to these things. But nevertheless, when in the 2000 election, George Bush and Al Gore had three debates. The word terrorism barely came up. It came up once and in passing. Al Gore was listing a few things and he included terrorism. Well, obviously it came to define the next two terms of George Bush's presidency, or the two terms of George Bush's presidency. When Woodrow Wilson was elected, he said, wouldn't it be funny if, having talked about domestic issues in this campaign, I would be weighed down by foreign policy issues? Well, he had to face World War I. So this happens constantly. Hoover said we're nearer to ending poverty than ever before in the election of 1928. So that didn't turn out. So the three huge challenges we have to face in the moment and that a leader is required to address are themselves a challenge, but they also point to another thing, which is the fourth, fifth, and sixth big challenge are on the horizon, whatever we may decide it is. And people should think about the presidency as somebody who can answer those challenges that we don't even know about yet. So to get back to your question, with the stakes so high, I would hope that we would both be a little bit more serious. That prioritization itself, which is important for the press, but the presidency too, would be something that was constantly as a part of our way of sorting and sifting ideas that come through. Is this the most important thing? Are Goya beans the most important thing that we should be talking about right now? That might sound a little fussy, what about the fun and the amusement of a campaign? We've seen the downside of not addressing some of these long-term challenges or having a team in place to address new ones. So maybe we can sideline some of the fun stuff for a moment while we're selecting the person who's going to make decisions that are going to deal with basically whether people live or die. So there's a lot of reason we should be a little bit more serious this time around.
Well, John, it was a great conversation. Thanks for joining us today.
Jake, I really appreciate it. I'd love to come back.
It was terrific.